In the last video, I introduced a new function called the Heaviside step function. That will be useful when we want to model, say, a piecewise continuous inhomogeneous term in the differential equation. Here is another function. It's called the Dirac delta function. It was introduced by Dirac when he was doing quantum mechanics. But then it's been widely adopted by engineers, scientists, everybody. It's very useful in modeling an impulse force. So an impulse force is like a force you apply to an object by hitting it with a hammer. So it's a very intense force over a very short period of time. So what is this Dirac delta function? It's not actually a function, but it's a limit of a function. And the easiest way to understand this is to draw a graph. So a Dirac delta function, if this is some graph of t, say, x versus t, the Dirac delta function is a function which is 0 until it gets to a point, which we can call c, and then it's infinite. And then it's 0 again, okay? So infinite, you would draw like a straight line here. Okay, it's kind of a strange function. But we can model that. You would model that by a limit of a real function. So this one here would go to infinity, but you would model that as a limit of a function. So here we would limit that by taking not quite infinite, but finite, and going up, say, at c minus epsilon, and coming back down at c plus epsilon. But how tall should this function be? So the idea of the Dirac delta function is that even though it's 0 everywhere except at one point where it's infinite, if you try to integrate that function, you end up with 1. So the area under the Dirac delta function should be 1. So we want the area in this rectangle to be 1. The width of the rectangle is 2 times epsilon, from c minus epsilon to c plus epsilon. So the height of this rectangle, this height here, should be 1 divided by 2 epsilon. So the area is 2 epsilon times 1 divided by 2 epsilon is 1. And the integral of this will then be 1, the area under the curve. And as epsilon goes to 0, you end up with the Dirac delta function, a width of 0 and a height of infinity. It's rather interesting, but we can model the Dirac delta function using Heaviside step functions. This would be a step up, step down function. So let's do the step up, step down function. So we can say that the Dirac delta function, I'll write that as delta of t minus c, which is the function that's 0 everywhere except where t equals c, at which it is infinite. And the integral of this function over t is 1. We can model this as the limit as epsilon goes to 0 of a function with a height 1 over 2 epsilon times a step up, step down function. So a step up, step down function, which you should have done in your homework problems, is a Heaviside step function at u of c minus epsilon. So that's 0 when t is less than c minus epsilon, and then becomes 1 when t is greater than c minus epsilon. So when t is greater than c minus epsilon, you're up here at 1 over 2 epsilon. And then you have to go back down. So you step down with a minus u of c plus epsilon of t. And that is a true function on the right-hand side. But then after you take the limit, you get this Dirac delta function, which mathematicians call a distribution rather than a function. But it works just like a function. What you can do with the Dirac delta function is do integrals. So for instance, if we use this, if we have the integral, let's say that c is greater than 0. So if we integrate from 0 to infinity of some function of t times the Dirac delta function of t minus c dt, how do we do that integral? It turns out that you will love Dirac delta functions because it makes doing integrals extremely easy. What is this integral? Well, so the limit from 0 to infinity crosses the 0 argument of the Dirac delta function. When the Dirac delta function has an argument of 0, which occurs at t equals c, then it will become infinite. But if t is different than c, then it's 0. So this integral is everywhere 0 except the integrand is everywhere 0 except when t is equal to c. So we can write this as we don't have to worry about the value of f anywhere except when t equals c. So we can just put in the value of c for the argument of f. So this is simply f of c times the integral from 0 to infinity of delta of t minus c dt. And now we're just integrating the Dirac delta function. So we've defined the Dirac delta function so that it has area 1 under the curve. So this integral is just 1. So we get f of c. Okay, so the beauty of the Dirac delta function when you're doing these integrals is it will just pick out the function that you're integrating against at the value where the argument of the Dirac delta function goes to 0. So here the integral of f of t delta of t minus c dt will just pick out f of c. This works provided that the limit then crosses the value where the delta function argument is 0. Okay, we're going to use Dirac delta function in our Laplace transform problems. So we're going to need to know what is the Laplace transform of the Dirac delta function. So we have the Laplace transform of delta of t minus c. That is also an integral. So that's an integral from 0 to infinity, e to the minus st times the function, delta of t minus c dt. C then is supposed to be somewhere between 0 and infinity. So again, this integral then will just pick out the value of the multiplying function when t is equal to c. So this integral is trivial to do. It's just e to the minus sc, or I'll write that as e to the minus cs. Okay. The results from the last video on the Heaviside step function for Laplace transforms and the result of the Dirac delta function is listed in the table. Let's have a look at the table now, and I'll show you where it is. If you look at the table, you'll see that line 12, 13, and 14 are the Heaviside step functions and the Dirac delta function. So line 12 tells us that the Laplace transform of uc of t is e to the minus cs divided by s. Line 13 tells us that the Laplace transform of uc of t times a shifted function f of t minus c is e to the minus cs times the Laplace transform of f. That line 13 is mainly useful for doing inverse Laplace transforms, and we'll see that in the next video. Finally, in line 14, I list the Laplace transform of the Dirac delta function. Delta of t minus c is equal to e to the minus cs. Let me review then. I introduce a new function in this video, the Dirac delta function, one of my favorite functions because it makes modeling of an impulse force very clean and allows you to do integrals that are otherwise impossible to do. We can model the Dirac delta function using a step-up, step-down function, and it just obeys the property that the width will go to zero and the height will go to infinity, but the area of that rectangle will stay constant of area 1. Because of that property, integrals become easy. If you integrate a function against the Dirac delta function, it just picks out the function at the value at which the Dirac delta, the argument of the Dirac delta function is 0. That allows us to do the Laplace transform of the Dirac delta function. The Dirac delta function, together with the Heaviside step function, Laplace transforms are shown in the table, so you don't need to do them again. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.